I'm so proud to be in this office, and the main reason is to represent 4.6 million people in this state. And what I have learned over the years, you may have seen it too, is when people come from outside of the state, they sometimes see things a little differently than we do. They see things we don't notice. And it was just as late as yesterday up in Chester, where GT Tire was open, they'd already built the building, but they hadn't started work yet, and they had the boss from Walmart was there as well. And he said, that Mr. Greg Ford from Walmart said, that South Carolina is different. He said, this is where you do big deals on a handshake. And this man, I can't remember, I think he was born in New Zealand, he's worked all over the world, and that's what he said. That had a familiar ring to it. Because these other companies that I've talked to, again, and I'm just focusing on those that have come from somewhere else, have said the same thing, but in different words. And up in Greer, just I guess about 6 weeks ago, they had the 25th year anniversary of BMW, which, as you know, is a big place, pumping out a new vehicle every 61.7 seconds. Yeah, every 61.7 seconds. Hard to believe. They were coming in, they're doubling the size of the plant right now. That was one of the things they announced. But the chairman of BMW said this. He said, South Carolina is a unique place. He said, the workforce is remarkable. It's different. He said, from any other place, the people are loyal, they're strong, they're willing to learn, they show up to work. And if the people of South Carolina give you their word, they will keep it. He said, and I quote, that's why we refer to South Carolina as a handshake state. I've heard the same thing from these other businesses. When we're trying to convince them to come here, we tell them about the research universities that have worked with them, and that's something that's unique in the country. Well, we have three research, USC, Princeton, and UNC, and the possibilities of collaboration between the young, bright students and the researchers and the engineers and the professors is something that these companies are eager and embrace, and it's something somewhat new, but we have those three research universities that are ready, willing, and able to do that. And that's why we see just around the corner here on the corner of Blossom and Assembly Street, IBM has their data analytics headquarters of the United States. That's why Boeing is giving the money for the aeronautical engineering. That's why Siemens gave a gift for software, the top of the line, most innovative stuff, worth $624 million, I think, to the University of South Carolina. All of this collaboration is something that they don't find in the other states. In addition, the best technical college system in the whole country started many years ago, but you know, on the Ready SC program, which people don't know this, we can take people from our technical colleges that go to a country and look at plan. He's thinking of moving to this country, South Carolina, and they will examine the plant, examine the machinery, examine the habits, the customs, all that, and come back and create a curriculum in our 16-location statewide technical college system where we can train our people how to work with those machines and produce those products for no cost. And you know who else does that in the United States? Nobody. That's right. Nobody does that. That's something that helps. Also, the Charleston port's getting deeper. Also, the Charleston port has two inland ports, one already working. If you go by and look through the trees and you can't see the ground up in Britain, you'll see those containers stacked up and cranes moving around. You'll think you can port Charleston. It is huge. And it's bringing people right in. Also, we have the lowest median participation in the whole country. Also, we have plenty of electric power, and we're working hard to see if we keep that going, because they can't come without plenty of electric power. By the way, that's another story. It's been very interesting after the bankruptcy of Westinghouse, and when we started discussing the possible sale of St. Petersburg and its property, which is a great asset, you'd be surprised, it's confidential, companies as well. But you would be surprised at the number of companies and people that are highly interested in getting a piece of South Carolina, that are interested in stepping into that and picking up some of those pieces and putting them back together, which if we run into a perfect storm of good luck and imagination, we may end up more than we had to begin with. Me, way too early to predict anything after all in the early phases. But you put all that together, and that is a combination of assets that we don't have in other states. Most states, of course, don't have a port, not on the ocean. These companies that are looking at us know that, but again, the main thing that they all say that they're looking for, the main thing is always the final factor, the main factor, the people of South Carolina. How we got the way we are, it's a long story, and a lot of people have ideas. For this. It's something that's working, and it's something that we can be very proud of. What I'm trying to do is to see that we do not lose our competitive advantage we have over other states and other places. I'm trying to see that we are broadly advertised and broadly engaged in international commerce and discussions, and that when people come here to take a look, we show them, we treat them with courtesy, which by the way, people say they've never seen such courtesy as someone from someplace else over the nation, just a little while ago, see the most courteous people in the United States and in South Carolina. This is something that really kind of shocked me to us. We knew everybody was courteous, but I've learned, ladies and gentlemen, in a lot of states, you walk down the street, nobody speaks to you. They don't even look at you. These people say, I'm a total stranger walking down the street in Spartanburg, Columbia, everybody's saying hello, good morning, thank you. I thought they did that everywhere, but they don't. But what I want to do is see that our tax system works. It is that not getting away with the growth, the economic growth we have. I left the office 2 minutes later getting good because we're having a deep conversation with some people who've been studying our tax code in all of these aspects to come up with some good reform that will take the burden off the people so we can go up. If we have good tax laws and rules, and if we have regulations that are only those that are necessary and not any more than that. This is an executive order for the agencies that are ought to do things. To go through the regulations, don't propose any new ones unless they can do the right thing, do the right job, and look and see if any others that are in existence now that are choking people and businesses. If we can do that, we can keep the environment, keep the streets moving, keep the crime down and under control, and that's a big job. And if we can educate the children, we've got to focus on educating the children. We can do that. And also, final point, if we can change the cultural attitude about higher education, there's nothing that can stop us. There's not another state that can keep up with us. What is the cultural attitude? Final point. Everybody in this room, we probably was encouraged go to college and get a 4-year diploma in something. And I guess a lot of people in the community did, and that's good. But the world has changed, and the demand for services and jobs has changed. And these factories, these plants have changed. Business has changed. The computer chip has just revolutionized everything. As you know, the steam engine did it, and now this is done. And these big plants that I've been to, I'm focusing on them because the example is so strong. You've got small businesses doing the same thing. GT yesterday, they got robots. It's a remarkable thing. And everybody in there, nobody carrying a toolbox anymore. Everybody's carrying a laptop. It's something. And it's high training. They're very sophisticated machines. And it's a lot of money in those jobs, and the best way to get from high school to left is to go through our technical college system, have great apprenticeships. We need to accelerate all of those programs so that the young people who want to use their brains and their hands will understand that they can make a lot of money if they want to finish up by getting a 4-year degree. You can even do it on the internet now. They can do that. But there's enormous opportunity in this new world. change in attitude on behalf of, I hope, society to realize that those are great, great jobs. So that's my story. And it really is a great story for South Carolina. It's a wonderful time to be doing business in this state. And I promise you, the people that are working at the state government are working hard. I know that others are working as well. We understand what we need to do in order to keep South Carolina competitive. Because these other governors and lieutenant governors and all these representatives of industry and business, the other states, I promise you, the 50 states out there, and they fight like maniacs, all of them that outthink and outwork the others to attract the business and to grow. But right now, we're right at the top. And if we all work together and keep these principles in mind, these ideas, I think that we can stay afloat and we'll have great, great prosperity in South Carolina. So I'm glad to be here with you. Welcome, all those of you from out of Columbia. Welcome. It's a great place. And that is my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Thank you, Governor.